Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
So today we'll be talking about respiratory system, third part, where we'll be talking about the infections of the lungs. So we have seen in my previous class regarding what are the normal defense mechanisms which prevents the infections. Depending on which part of the lung or which part of the respiratory tract is infected, we have separate names. For example, if infection in the nose, there is a specific terminology, we call it as rhinitis. If the inflammation occurs in the pharynx, which is present just below the nose, we call it as pharyngitis. And the last component of the upper respiratory tract, or you can say the beginning of lower respiratory tract, is larynx. If there is infection or inflammation of the larynx, we call it as laryngitis. Below the larynx, we have trachea and its branches, that is tracheobronchial tree. So when there is infection of the trachea, if it is infection limited to the trachea, we call it as tracheitis. And infection limited to the major bronchus, we call it as bronchitis. So all of you observe, there is itis. If you recollect your general pathology, whichever organ is inflamed will put itis in the end. Rhinitis, pharyngitis, laryngitis, tracheitis, and bronchitis. Most of the times, these two, inflammation of the trachea and bronchi, they occurs together. We call it as tracheobronchitis. If the inflammation is limited to the terminal bronchiole, okay, we call it as bronchiolitis. Again, itis means inflammation. Which part of the respiratory system is infected, we add prefix to that itis. So bronchiolitis. In the same way, any kind of an infection or inflammation which is present in the lung, I mean to say, which the main purpose is respiratory bronchioles, or it may include terminal bronchioles, and the alveolar sac, So when you have inflammation which is limited to these structures, we commonly, in a layman terminology, we call it as pneumonia. Hence, pneumonia is nothing but inflammation of the lung parenchyma, predominantly limited to the respiratory bronchiole, terminal bronchiole, and alveolar sac. So, in today's lectures, we will be talking about pneumonia. Right? In my previous class, I mentioned what are the normal defense mechanisms, which prevents the infection of the lung parenchyma. If they are working normally in a normal anatomical position, anatomical function in a healthy individuals. Those are, if I repeat, one is cough reflex, second one, if you can recollect, mucociliary clearance, and finally we have alveolar macrophages. Alveolar macrophages. This sign we use it for macrophages. Impairment of any of these normal mechanisms ultimately leads to infection. You can see there are two pictures there. On your left side, you have normal lung alveoli. If you can see normal alveoli, you have thin interalveolar septae and alveoli with clear lumen. Sometimes you can see occasional alveolar macrophages, third line of defense. This is the normal. When this part is infected, that is inflammation of the alveoli, a lung parenchyma, where you can see this, call it as, we mention it as pneumonia, where these empty alveolar spaces is filled up with inflammatory cells. All the alveoli, they show lumen, are filled up with inflammatory cells. And the interalveolar septa, if you can see, there is congestion of the interalveolar septal capillaries. Again, this is one of the signs or symptoms of inflammation. Congestion of the septal capillaries, presence of inflammatory cells in the alveolar lumen is pneumonia. So, let's see, what are the risk factors of pneumonia? All of you can see, usually all of us healthy individuals, we inhale a lot of microorganisms, but none of us will get affected with pneumonia. Why? Because we have integrated the defense mechanisms. In some individuals, for example, in childhood or infants, where the mucociliary escalator and the immune system is not developed properly, those are the groups which are more prone for lung infection. One thing. In elderly age group, so where the immune system is suppressed or decreased, or even the mucociliary escalator is decreased, so those are the patients who are more prone for lung infection. See, early age and late age, the most common age group which are affected with lung infection. Then what are the risk factors of affecting lung infection in the middle age individuals? Any patient having a chronic medical condition, any kind of chronic medical condition like malignancies, chronic liver disease, chronic heart diseases, any kind of neurodegenerative disorders, all will have somewhere affect the normal defense mechanisms. So these patients are more prone to develop lung infections. Secondly, as I mentioned, extremes of life, either infants, all of you might have experienced, infants or children below the age of 5 years are more commonly present with lung infections. Similarly, early age and very old age, they are more common. That means extremes of age, extremes age group, they are more prone for lung infections. And all individuals who have immunodeficiency disorders, immunodeficiency disorders, they are more prone to develop lung infections. Who are all? Any kind of hematolymphoid malignancies, patients with hematolymphoid malignancies, patients with HIV, retroviral infections. So all those patients, they are more prone to develop, or they are the patient who are risk of developing lung infections. Fourthly, any patient where the spleen has been removed, that means absent spleen, absent spleen. In splenectomized individual, splenectomy individuals. So spleen, all of us know that it is one of the reticuloendothelial system. Main function is to clear off microorganisms by splenic macrophages. If spleen is removed, these organisms cannot be removed from the circulation. Hence, the patient, the organisms will enter the pulmonary circulation. They are more prone to develop pulmonary infections. Pulmonary infections, that is pneumonia. So, these four important risk factors all of you should remember. Next. So this is the schematic diagram. If you can see, this is one normal alveoli. There is one alveoli which is affected. Normal alveoli is clear. On your left side, you can see air particles are entering into the normal alveoli. Here, one more alveoli which is infected or inflamed alveoli, where the alveolar lumen is filled up with all the inflammatory cells and exudates. This is the lining epithelium exudate. Whole thing is filled up with inflammatory cells and exudates. This is the trachea. So what happens? How these patients presents? All these lung infection patients, when they are in moderate to severe grade, where lungs are involved more than one lobe, they present with hypoxemia. That means decreased oxygen contents in the blood. At the same time, you have increased carbon dioxide concentration in the thing. So whenever you have decreased oxygen saturation in the blood, patient usually present with dyspneic episodes, and he'll become weak, breathlessness, tachypnea, all those symptoms these pneumonia patients will present. How? What is the pathophysiology behind this? When you have a clear alveoli, air will enter into the alveoli and there is an easy diffusion of gases. One, oxygen will come out. At the same time, carbon dioxide will go out. That will be expired through the nose. What happens? When the alveoli, which are inflamed, especially in pneumonia patients, air cannot enter. Air will enter till the terminal bronchial, but it cannot enter the alveolar sac because whole of the alveolar lumen is filled up with inflammatory exudative fluid. And blood vessels are here. So proper diffusion of gases cannot take place because of this barrier. So oxygen will not come into the blood circulation. Carbon dioxide will not expire. So in the blood level, if you see in this patient, have decreased oxygen saturation. We call it as hypoxemia. Hypoxemia, at the same time, increased carbon dioxide retention. So this is the, so when you have decreased oxygen saturation, you present with different clinical signs and symptoms of respiratory infections. This is the simple pathophysiological mechanisms in all pneumonia patients. Let's see. We learned about definition of pneumonia, what pneumonia is. We learned about the pathophysiology of pneumonia, how it occurs, how it looks on a microscopy. And now we see the how to classify pneumonia, lung infection. Is it same or lung pneumonia means everything? No. So there is certain clinical pathological classification that has been followed and easy for both the pathologist, clinicians and treating physician. So we divide. So categories. How do we divide pneumonia? How do we classify pneumonia? There are seven categories of pneumonia depending on what causes. It is very simple. One, the most common one is community. Each word is very important. All of you should know and remember. Community acquired typical pneumonia. That means community acquired typical pneumonia. First thing. Second one is community, again, acquired, instead of typical, you have atypical pneumonia. Community acquired typical pneumonia. I'll be explaining each words later. Community acquired atypical pneumonia. Third category is nosocomial pneumonia. Nosocomial pneumonia. It is also called as hospital acquired pneumonia. Hospital acquired pneumonia. Pneumonia occurring in hospital setup. Fourth category is aspiration pneumonia. Aspiration pneumonia. Fifth category is necrotizing pneumonia. Necrotizing pneumonia. Sixth category is chronic pneumonias. Chronic pneumonia. And the last one, again most important, is pneumonia or lung infection occurring in immunodeficiency individuals. Immunodeficiency individuals. These seven categories are very, very, very important. We'll go one by one. Now, first I'll repeat: community acquired typical pneumonias, community acquired atypical pneumonias, pneumonias occurring in hospital setup, we call it as nosocomial pneumonias, aspiration pneumonia, that means it indicates the cause of pneumonia, pneumonia occurring due to aspiration, they kept it in a separate category. So it is easy for everybody to understand. If I say aspiration pneumonia, then everybody will understand that the lung infection is due to aspiration of some foreign material. Next, necrotizing pneumonia. Some organisms, they are more prone to cause a severe lung damage and causes lung parenchymal necrosis. So those are categorized in necrotizing pneumonia. Chronic pneumonia. So these type of pneumonias occur throughout the long duration of they will have long duration. That's why they call it as chronic pneumonia. Why it is important? Only certain organisms are more prone to cause chronic pneumonia. In Indian setup, Mycobacterium tuberculosis, TB, is one of the most common in our India. And along with that, any kind of fungal infections. So Mycobacterium tuberculosis, TB, and fungal infections, they are the more common cause of chronic pneumonia. Last one is pneumonia occurring in immunodeficiency individual. This is very important because organisms which are causing pneumonia in these, they will not cause any kind of lung infection in healthy individuals, right? So this is the classification all of you should know. Now we'll go one by one. First, we'll talk about community acquired typical pneumonia. All of us in the class, sometime and other time, we are affected with some kind of a lung infections. Okay, most example is viral infections. I will say, if I am getting infected in my family, I will be the person, then I will transmit the same infection to my siblings, wife, parents, or daughter or sister, daughter or brother. So persons or individuals living in a close family, they get infected. That means that's a close community. That is one, because of close approximation. The people who are staying in hostels, they are in close contact with each other. So the chances of spreading infection from one individual to another individual in that community is more. So all of you might have observed same thing. Okay, the infection, if something comes in my family, they said, they will say, "Acha, you take care of it. Anyway, I am going to get the infection." Why? Because of this thing. So this is why, because this kind of lung infection occurring in an individual which are in close approximation, in the school, for example, school in the same sections, one person gets, the other children will also get infection. So close community. So lung infection occurring in the close community and it is acquired. Why I am using acquired means, if I get an infection, I will spread the infection to the other individual, my close friend, my close family member. So that person is getting infection from my droplets. So it is acquired. He is acquiring infection from me. It is acquired and it is lung infection. That's what we call it as pneumonia. Pneumonia, lung infection, which is acquired, present in the close community, we call it as community acquired typical pneumonia. Now, the word which is left is typical. Why we are saying typical in this individual means, all those patients who have community acquired typical pneumonias, they have clear cut clinical features, signs and symptoms of pneumonia. Radiologically also, there is no doubt, the radiologist can say that it is a pneumonia. Lab investigation, if you send the blood, they will say it is an infection. So even the biopsy, in case if you find the biopsy material also shows infection. So there is no doubt. For example, what are those characteristic features of classical pneumonia or typical pneumonia? That means, one, the patient should have sudden onset of fever, high grade fever with chills and rigor. That means patient is having fever. Infection is confirmed because he is presenting with fever. It is severe grade because it is also presenting with chills and rigors, right? Same patient, they show pleuritic type of chest pain. Pleuritic chest pain. So when they are respirating, they will say sharp pricking pain in the thoracic cavity. That means infection, which is limited to the thoracic cavity. These patients will have more increased production of sputum. Increased production of sputum. Again, increased production of sputum. Sputum is secreted from the respiratory tract, tracheobronchial tree. When there is increased production, that means that there is some kind of an infection or inflammation in the lungs, tracheobronchial lung. These two, pleuritic chest pain and increased production of cough, shows that lung is getting infected. There is an infected lung. Inflammation is limited to the lungs. Sudden onset of fever, chills and rigor shows that there is a systemic symptoms. And when you take chest x-ray of this individual, radiologically clear cut, they say the diagnosis of lobar consolidation or pneumonia. Radiologist in chest x-ray, I will show you the pictures in my next slides. Radiologist will also say there is some haziness in the lung parenchyma and it is a pneumonia. And there is a clear-cut evidence of consolidation. So that's why these patients will have sudden onset of high-grade fever with chills and rigors, pleuritic chest pain, increased production of sputum, lobar consolidation on x-ray. If you send the blood sample of these patient for analysis, it shows leukocytosis, increased white blood cell count. It also shows there is infection. Everything is clear because these patients will show these kind of all typical features. We call it as typical pneumonia, right? All of you understood? Community, acquired, these are the typical signs and symptoms, radiological and laboratory parameters, and there is a lung infections. So these, whenever patient comes to the clinical OPD, when they have presented with these kind of radiology and this thing, they will be categorized as community acquired typical pneumonia. Let's see, what are the common organisms which can cause this kind of pneumonia, right? The most common organisms which causes community acquired typical pneumonia are Streptococcus pneumoniae. All of you should remember at least 2 to 3 organisms. Streptococcus pneumonia is one of the most common organisms. Second, Staphylococcus aureus, and especially in children, if pneumonia occurs in children and elderly individuals, most common organisms is Haemophilus influenza. All of you should remember at least these three important microorganisms. So if somebody asks what are the common organisms which causes community acquired typical pneumonia, you should be able to say Streptococcus pneumoniae, Staphylococcus aureus, and Haemophilus influenza. This is about community acquired typical pneumonia. Okay, this is some, you can make out, you can see some tabular column in that, usual pathogens which are causing community acquired typical pneumonia, Streptococcus pneumoniae, and we have Haemophilus influenza, Moraxella catarrhalis. These are the important organisms. Next, second category, I will wipe out these organisms and I will keep everything same here. Second category is, now I will make one into two. community acquired instead of typical, I'll put atypical pneumonia. Everything is same. It is occurring in the close community, family, school children, or in the same class, same community, infection is same. It is acquired because one person, if gets infected, the other person, the chances of getting infection is high. That this infection spreads by the droplets. Acquired. It is a pneumonia because lung is the most common thing involved in it, and it is atypical. Only word difference is atypical. We are calling it as atypical means you know that by clinical signs and symptoms there is some kind of an infection in the lung. You can evaluate, but the patient will not have high grade fever. So I'll strike out. Patient might have mild grade fever, showing that there is some kind of an infection. No chills and rigors. He will not have any chills and rigors. Pleuritic chest pain may be minimal, may be present, may not be present. And sputum production, very minimal, not increased, mild or no sputum production. And when you take radiology, it is not clear to say that there is typical lobar consolidation. There is some haziness, but radiologists can also not say that it is a typical case of pneumonia. That means they are in a doubt. So there is question mark, typical, the haziness on X-ray, one thing. And when you send the blood sample, leukocytosis may be, blood counts may be normal or mildly elevated. So everything is plus minus, that's why we call it as atypical. Okay, why it is important? There are certain organisms, they present with this kind of features. You can suspect that if any patient comes with these kind of features, the common organisms causing these are these. You can treat the patient immediately with broad spectrum antibiotics or any symptomatic treatments. So what are the organisms which causing community acquired atypical pneumonia? Most common causes are viruses, right? You will get mild grade fever, mild weakness, mild cough, okay? The most common. In that, we have influenza, para-influenza viruses, respiratory syncytial virus, and various groups of adenovirus. Any kind of viruses, they can cause community-acquired atypical pneumonia. And you have Haemophilus, para-influenza, mycoplasma organisms, and chlamydia species. If you prescribe antibiotics in virus pneumonia, community acquired atypical pneumonia, it may not work. Even if you take antibiotics, the symptoms and signs will persist for at least 10 to 15 days, 1 week, 10 days. Okay. But in my previous class, classification, community acquired typical pneumonia mainly caused by bacteria. Okay, streptococcus pneumonia, if you prescribe antibiotics, they will respond easily. So this is how you should differentiate between community acquired typical pneumonia and community acquired atypical pneumonia. Okay, so you should be very clear because this is the most common types of pneumonia that we are going to see in the clinical practice. There is a tabular column in the slide next to you. And you can make out the differences between the typical pneumonia and atypical pneumonia. I have already mentioned all those things here. And one more important thing I would like to mention here is sputum. So I told you that sputum production is more prominent in community acquired typical pneumonia. So is it possible for me to guess the organisms by seeing the sputum specimens? That means, looking at the sputum, can you say which organism is infected? Yes. There are certain organisms, they produce certain characteristic sputum color and odor. By looking at the sputum, you can say that this is the organism which is getting infected. Without going for culture and sensitivity, you can prescribe the antibiotic which are sensitive to that organism in that locality. So what are those important examples? One, all of you should remember. So, I'll be talking about the sputum characteristics. Sputum. For example, if the patient present with a rusty colored sputum, you can see the picture in that thing. If the sputum is rusty in color, copious amount of rusty in color, that means that patient is commonly infected with pneumococcal pneumonia. Pneumococcus is the organisms which causes rusty color in the sputum. Next, if the patient says that, or if you see the sputum is of green in color, I'll expectorate a lot of green color sputum. That means you can see in the second picture, it is common organisms which produces green color sputum is Pseudomonas. Pseudomonas are very dangerous organisms. These are the organisms which are responsible for the common hospital acquired infections. Green color. Next is, if bed say ki we have got red color or apple jelly kind of a sputum, current jelly sputum, which is shown in the third box. If anybody says current jelly or bloody colored sputum, mucoid color sputum, most common organism is Klebsiella. Okay, if someone says I have a copious amount of sputum but it is very foul smelling, that means the fourth category is foul smelling sputum. When they say foul smelling sputum, the commonest organisms for foul smelling sputum is anaerobic organisms. I repeat, depending on the sputum characteristics, we can judge or we can presume the organisms which is causing pneumonia. First, if the patient says the rusty color sputum, the common organism is pneumococcus. If it is the sputum color is green in color, we have Pseudomonas infection. Current jelly kind of sputum, blood mixed with mucoid color sputum, most common organism is Klebsiella. And if they say a sputum, if the patient comes with a sputum bottle, if he opens in front of you, it is smelly, foul smelling sputum, you can make out. So if any kind of a sputum with that color, that means patient has got anaerobic infection. You can treat with anaerobic antibiotics, which are sensitive to anaerobic organisms at the same time, immediately. So these are the important things you should remember in pneumonia. Next, the further categories of pneumonia, I'll be taking up in next class.